Welcome. This is the mic. Okay. There's a lot of mics up here. Welcome. Thank you all for joining us today. My name is Becky Gray. I'm with the John Locke Foundation, and we are delighted to be able to present this very thoughtful discussion of a very important issue, certificate of need laws in North Carolina. We're going to go ahead and get started. Now, I just kind of want to give everybody a heads up. Those of you that work and live at the General Assembly are very familiar with this phenomenon. We've got a lot of meetings going on. The House is actually in appropriations, budget committees, session goes in for the Senate at 4 o'clock. So we're going to have people coming in and out through the afternoon. So I'm just kind of giving you a heads up on that. But thank you all for being here today. Again, we're delighted that you could join us, and we're delighted to be able to put on this program. Certificate of need laws in this issue is not a new issue in North Carolina. As a matter of fact, for probably 25 years, we have been focusing on this. We've been writing, gathering data, providing information, giving our opinion on what should happen with certificate of need laws. And as a matter of fact, I think you all received a paper that Dr. Roy Cordata of the Locke Foundation did. The title of this is Certificate of Need Laws, It's Time for Repeal. And if you look at the bottom, the date on this is November 2005. So for over a decade, the Locke Foundation has been writing and working on this particular issue, providing information. And we've been concerned about a loss of healthcare freedom. With the loss of access, limited access, with increased cost with health care, with the lack of innovation, many things that are preventing the development of the doctor-patient relationship. Again, we're very concerned about government involvement in health care and the loss of freedom that we have seen in health care. As a matter of fact, we have a website devoted to that, restorehealthcarefreedom.com, and there's information about that on the back of your program. I hope you'll take a look at that. So for 2016, we have turned our attention to restoring that healthcare freedom. We believe that lots of options, affordable care, choices based on what patients and our doctors want, not what government officials say that we want, is the answer to restoring healthcare freedom. So we've been talking about ideas, we've been taking suggestions, we've been consulting national experts, we've been working with many legislative leaders on this certificate of need law, and thought that it would just be very timely to bring some of those experts together and offer you all a very thoughtful discussion of certificate of need laws. Now, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, just real quick, certificate of need laws require that medical facilities, medical providers get a permission slip before they expand their facilities, before they offer more access, before they offer lower cost. And we believe, again, that this is taking away healthcare freedom. So when we were putting this discussion together and deciding who we wanted to invite to be part of that, we wanted additional thought leaders, people who are used to having these discussions, leading these discussions on many of these important issues. And so, of course, our attention went to Tom Campbell, the moderator and host of NC-SPIN. Many of you all are familiar with Tom, and so he has agreed to come and lead this discussion for us. So Tom, if you'd like to come up and get started, and while you're making your way to the podium, I'll mention that Senator Hise is going to have to duck out early. The Senate session starts at 4 o'clock, and he's going to stay with us as long as he possibly can until he's required to go down and make his first vote for the day. So we're going to change the program around a little bit, and Senator Hise is going to go first. But first, Tom's going to introduce the idea. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you, Becky. Every era has an issue or several issues that sort of frame it for history. And the big issue of our era is health care. There's no question that America cannot continue to spend 17% or more of its gross domestic product on health care. We have an extremely complex public-private system in America. The Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare as it's commonly called, was intended to reform health care, bring down costs, but most people now are of the opinion that it has not lived up to its promises and expectations. Health insurance costs continue to escalate every year as much as 30% in premium increases. Pharmaceutical costs are higher in this country than the same prescriptions cost in other countries. Hospitals continue to consolidate, buy up medical practices, and statistics will show you that despite all of the innovations in technology and in techniques, new procedures, that our people in this country rank in the middle of other nations in overall health. Americans are not satisfied with the healthcare system that they have, and if you think they're upset about it, you ought to meet the doctors and talk with them. They are as frustrated as are the patients. Healthcare reform is obviously a topic that is important, it is timely, and it is needed. And one reform that is being advocated by many is certificate of need reform that appear to restrict competition and cause many patients to pay more for procedures than is necessary. So we're gathered here today to talk about that. We have a number of key players who will be with us. Obviously, one of the important and essential discussion leaders in this are the hospitals of North Carolina. They were issued an invitation to appear on this panel and to be part of this discussion today, but declined. And personally, that is very disappointing. But you have in the brochures that you've been given the introductions to our panelists. We will talk a little bit more about them, but I want to begin with Senator Ralph Hise, who is probably one of the more knowledgeable legislators in our General Assembly, certainly in the Senate, on health care. And he's going to talk to us for just a few minutes about the legislative background, the challenges, and where he thinks certificate of need reform is going to go. Senator?
Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Becky, for the opportunity. Again, I will apologize for the chaotic nature of this schedule, but I don't get to control that. They just tell me when to show up, and that's kind of how this works. That's what coming in. But it's kind of interesting time in the General Assembly, and has been for 5 years now. When the leadership changed here, I don't think anyone will doubt that we came here with an obligation of we're going to reduce the size of government. You've seen for 5 years now, one of the hallmarks of every legislative session is we come out with our regulatory reform bill. We go around to business and industries and hear from them all over the state and say, where is the regulatory problems you're dealing with in government that prevent you from being successful? Now, the truth of that is that started with lower hanging fruit. That's what coming in. The first ones were really easy. Everybody had a lot of ideas of what we could get rid of. And the ones that we could move quickly, we did. We got a lot of success out of that. Every year as we've gone on, we've still been able to populate that with things we can do for businesses, but it gets a little harder and harder every time. And we've really begun to reach that point that even though it's been a concern of many in the industry and others from the first time we tried this, is we're reaching CON. And when you look at how it impacts our community, you know, when I grew up in Western North Carolina, the industries that were really dominant in Western North Carolina were tobacco, textiles, and furniture. It's coming in. Look around now, those are all gone for all practical purposes. They're not dominating any. Now, every county I have is in this balance of whether it's healthcare as the dominant industry or government. That's what we have, and that's the picture all across rural North Carolina. So coming in, and one of the major holdbacks in rural areas is that we have this certificate of need system that is incredibly expensive to enter into the market and by its nature restrictive for allowing the industry to expand. First got in this when I was mayor and the community wanted to have a new assisted living facility. That's what coming in within Mitchell County. Well, Mitchell County only has 16,000 people. We can fill a facility, but we had to show that we had the CON slots that were available to fill the facility. We had to barter with other with the one skilled nursing facility we had for who was covering what. We finally got enough to open a 50-bed unit. That's what's coming in. That's all that could be done. We have a tremendous resource and beauty in Western North Carolina that a lot of people would choose to come there and retire, but we have to look at our own population numbers in a small circle and say, how does that fit for what we have existing in the community? Nowhere to CON look out and say what could be available in a community. It's all about what is there. And I talked to an individual from Graham County wanting to do a mental health facility, 27-bed mental health facility, 2 years ago. The legal cost to perform his application for CON was over $300,000, for which he dropped the entire project. We're done. For those of you who know, mental health is not really the high-paying sector of healthcare that's coming in. And so when you're looking at a business that may be borderline for what it's going, you know, that's what choices you make. So I kind of looked at this, I've all the time been looking at this kind of regulation and why is it there. I get that historically, people wanting to build a hospital in a rural area and had to finance it, had to go to the banks and others and say, you know, how do I make this work? And if you could guarantee to the bank that you had no competition for the next 30 years, it was easier to get money loaned to you. Now, I would submit to you that under Dodd-Frank and others, most of your hospitals probably aren't going to the bank for their loan guarantee right now. Most of them happen to be going into the retained earnings for the larger hospital that already owns them and is making the investment. Think about if you need an MRI machine, and everyone talks about rural health care. If you need a population of 100,000 to support an MRI machine, what's the odds of that ever being located in a rural community? I guess if you happen to be in the midpoint between two in mid-urban areas, you might hope that you could capture both. I also serve on SHEP as part of my roles in the legislature that makes these determinations. They have a lot of long discussions about gamma knives and others and the applications and whether it's a mobile machine or a fixed machine, how that fits in, MRI units. We really tossed them on their head when industry developed one that moved. I mean, that was kind of the, how do you deal with that? That's what coming in, because, oh, well, we can determine if a hospital might need one. That's what coming in, but if you could move it somewhere for 2 days, where does that fit in the numbers? So we had to come up with its own system of CONs for mobile units. That's what coming in. So how do we regulate those? So I think you start to see kind of all the challenges that exist in this industry. The other is in healthcare delivery. Whoever said an MRI only has to be used for the exact things it's being used for today? I talked to a doctor, was actually out of Maryland, who had revolutionary began using an MRI machine for individuals who would not have a colonoscopy. That was coming in. So we had to, these individuals need to be checked for prostate cancer and others, but quite frankly, they weren't going through that procedure. I understand that. That's what's coming in. So he was able to take those individuals and do an MRI on them. Talked about the number of cases he identified of pancreatic and prostate cancer that the person would never have gone in for if they'd had to have the colonoscopy. But he can't get an MRI machine to begin the practice because that's not a normal use of the MRI machine. Therefore, it's when does it schedule in the open times of the existing one at the hospital? That's a ridiculous limitation on healthcare. That's what's coming in. And all of those limitations means that we don't develop healthcare in the rural areas, and we place an expectation, like for most of my residents, that you get to drive an hour and 15 minutes to Asheville for any significant procedures. Quite frankly, the limitation of building, and then we worry about competition. In Spruce Pine, where I'm from, no one's going to not build another hospital because of CON. No one's going to build, they're not going to build another hospital because it's a bad business decision to put two major hospitals in a small rural area. That's what's coming in. But we somehow think that CON is what prevents all that, and keep someone from swallowing up our hospital is because the competitors will want to lose, you know, $20, $25 million a year to put one there just to wait for the other one to collapse and open a facility that doesn't make money itself. So these are kind of the environments we're in. I would tell you from a legislative perspective, I believe strongly that CON will end. That's what's coming in. I think the conversation now is about when and how. That's what's coming in. There are individuals out there making some cases and saying, but we've made this investment under the current system. So we are having a conversation about, well, how do we allow that to kind of end out, and how do we say to the industry now and others, plan for the future, because this is not going to be here. You know, that's a statement I would make to all of healthcare right now. Plan for the future, because the current system's not going to be here. Whether that's CON or whether that's any of these areas, just look at what the Affordable Care Act has done in 3-4 years in North Carolina, and everything in healthcare is sitting on its ear right now. That's what's coming in. So CON is going to end. We're going to have that conversation about how and when. And those that are fighting it are fighting the inevitable tide. That's what's coming in, and just hoping for one more year. But quite frankly, the healthcare providers I talk to all across the state, I think they understand that. The hospitals I talk across the state, they understand that. This is not a system that's going on forever. Sooner or later, we're going to open this and let healthcare innovate and reduce costs for all of us. So that's kind of my conversation I wanted to put out there and those kind of things. But then I got some others, and I'll be willing to get some questions if I've got a few minutes. I haven't got to ask
yet.
Yeah,
Senator, before you leave, I do want to I appreciate the words that you gave us. Are we going to see any action on this in the short session, or is it going to be 2017 before we might see some action on CON?
Don't have my crystal ball that was coming in, and I rarely get to guess on what the House is going to do. I will kind of leave that as saying that I'm still fighting on this session. I'm still fighting for a repeal this session, and by no means have any indication that I should give up that fight at this point. So we may only have about 4 to 6 weeks left, but keep your eye open for any opportunities. And if you see any opportunities, let me know. That's what's coming in. I plan to run everything through them I can.
Thank you, Senator. If you can stay around for some questions, and then before you have to go vote, then we'd like to have that. Otherwise, we're going to proceed on and take our next presenter.
Thank you.
By the way, I will mention that we will be taking questions from the audience, depending on what time we have left. So you might begin formulating them based on our speakers. Our second speaker today is Christopher Koopman. He's with the Mercatus Center at George Washington University. Chris is going to provide some background and history for us on Certificate of Need. How did we get where we are? Chris?
Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you to John Locke Foundation for the invitation to speak on this issue today. I haven't been working on this quite as long as Roy and others at John Locke, but I've committed a substantial portion of my professional career to this issue up to this point. And thank you all for joining me and the others here to talk about what I think is perhaps one of the more it's an issue that's just simply lacking attention, but it seems to be growing across the country, and I will get to that in a minute. But I think it's important to understand how we got here, the history behind Certificate of Need. I think it's important to understand where North Carolina compares to the rest of the country. And then finally, with the work that I and others at the Mercatus Center have been doing, we can talk a little bit about what does this actually mean for providers, and more importantly, what does this actually mean for patients and those seeking quality care in North Carolina. But first, how did we get here? So you have to go back a ways to the beginning of Certificate of Need. So a brief history lesson here. 1964, New York State enacts the first Certificate of Need law in the country. It was a way to give more power to these regional planning boards throughout the state of New York, but more importantly, it was an attempt by the state to centrally plan their healthcare market. Over the next 10 years, about a dozen other states adopt this this approach toward regulating healthcare until Congress gets involved. The National Health Planning Resources Development Act of 1974, Congress decides that those states that have not adopted certificate of need programs must adopt them in order to receive federal funds. Now this is important in particular because the federal government was worried about Medicare reimbursements. And under the old Medicare reimbursement system, hospitals and providers were actually reimbursed for capital investments. So the federal government was very worried about what type of investments hospitals and providers at a local level were making. And so they passed this mandate on states to create their own certificate of need programs. It's important, however, to note that it wasn't just cost control that the federal government was worried about. It was also things, and this is in the original bill, things like ensuring the equitable distribution of healthcare resources across the state, ensuring rural access, ensuring quality, ensuring charity care, and all sorts of other idealistic goals. But nonetheless, this was an attempt to create a better healthcare market through central planning, through these certificate of need boards. 10 years later, 1986, so 12 years later, the federal government has since changed their reimbursement program. So it no longer makes sense, first of all, to have certificate of need programs. But also, they have 10 years of evidence that these programs simply don't work. Up to that point, there was very little, if no, academic evidence at that point that certificate of need laws had achieved any substantive cost control at all in their respective healthcare markets. So the federal government repeals the mandate. 1986, it goes away. 10 states almost immediately repeal their own respective certificate of need programs. And over the course of the 30 years since, another 4 states have repealed their programs to get us to the current number of 36 states in DC that continue to regulate in this way. Now, where does North Carolina stand of these states that have kept these programs in place? North Carolina has the fourth most restrictive program that covers 25 different items. The average state's program of those states that have a certificate of need program cover around 14. North Carolina covers 25. The only states that are more restrictive than North Carolina are Vermont at number one, DC at number two, and Hawaii at number three. So that's where North Carolina stands compared to other certificate of need programs across the country. But what does this mean for care? After all, that should be what healthcare policy is all about, is the provision of care and patients at the end of the day. So what does this mean? And let's go back to some of these initial justifications, because I think ultimately that's how you can measure the success or failure of these policies, is are they actually achieving their stated goals? Cost control, we have some 40 years of evidence that it doesn't control costs. We knew this in 1986, and all we have now is 30 more years of evidence that it doesn't control costs. But what about these other goals that people have attached to certificate of need programs? Things like protecting rural care. Well, recent empirical research that I've done with a professor at George Mason, Thomas Stratman, we've looked at this issue and we've said, what is the relationship between regulating the entry in a healthcare market through certificate of need and the number of hospitals and ambulatory surgery centers, both across the state overall and in particular in rural communities? And here's what we found. In states that have a certificate of need program, the presence of that program is correlated with 30% fewer overall hospitals. They have a third fewer hospitals in those states that don't have a program. In rural communities, they also have 30% fewer hospitals than those states that do not have certificate of need programs. So if the goal was to protect hospitals from competition, thereby ensuring access, these programs have failed. What does this mean for ambulatory surgery centers? For ASCs, overall, 15% fewer overall ASCs in states that regulate healthcare via certificate of need program versus those that don't. And the same also holds for rural communities. So this is doing nothing to protect access in rural communities. And in fact, you find fewer providers in rural communities in certificate of need states versus non-certificate of need states. For a state like North Carolina, North Carolina, in the last year that we had data for in our study, had 132 overall hospitals, a non-certificate of need state similarly situated would have had 187. In rural communities, North Carolina had 56 rural community hospitals. In a state similarly situated without a certificate of need program like North Carolina, would have had somewhere estimated 80 rural community hospitals. The same also holds for ambulatory surgery centers. Again, you'd have more ambulatory surgery centers both overall and in rural communities. Look at medical imaging. Senator Hise was talking about the medical imaging. What is regulating healthcare look like in medical imaging? Well, we find in recent research looking at specifically medical imaging and certificate versus non-certificate of need states, 34% fewer MRI scans being done in certificate of need states, 44% fewer CT scans being done in certificate of need states, and 65% fewer PET scans done in certificate of need states. People are using these services less in certificate of need states. In North Carolina, again, 96,000 MRI scans were done in the last year that we measured. In a similarly situated state without a certificate of need program, North Carolina would have had 150,000 MRI scans done. Now, this isn't, and again, I think an argument that many proponents of certificate of need programs make is that they are somehow controlling for overutilization. That is, if you have all of these doctors with all of these MRI machines, then they're going to try to recoup their investments by giving people superfluous MRI scans, or so the argument goes. Although the data, looking at Medicare beneficiaries, the data seems to indicate that while there are fewer MRI scans, CT scans, and PET scans occurring in certificate of need states, patients are actually leaving and getting those services done in non-certificate of need states. So, for example, our recent research that we did a few months ago looking at this found that you have, controlling for everything else, you have 3.93% more people leaving a state with certificate of need to get scans out of state than in state. What does this mean for North Carolina? That means 9,000 people approximately are going out of state to get MRI scans that would be getting them in state if there wasn't a certificate of need program. That is, you know, there are fewer options for them, prices are higher, because there is overall less competition. The same also goes for CT scans and PET scans. 3.5% more CT scans are being done on North Carolina patients out of state versus that getting them completed in state. And almost 10% PET scans. So this means 19,000 folks are going out of state approximately to get CT scans done elsewhere. They're going to states like Georgia, South Carolina, Tennessee, Florida. All of the states surrounding North Carolina that have chosen not to regulate medical imaging with a certificate of need program. And ultimately, that should be the focus of any conversation about healthcare in North Carolina or across the country, is what is it doing to patients? And for patients who are looking for greater access, greater availability, more competition, lower prices, and ultimately more options for individuals seeking quality care, the data is clear on this. Certificate of need programs aren't assisting them in that, and in many ways may actually be hindering their options and ultimately stifling their ability to get the care they want in their own communities. So with that, I will stop there, and I will I guess move on to the next panelist. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris, for that good background on how we got to where we are. Katherine Restrepo is the Health and Human Services Analyst for the John Locke Foundation. She's done quite a bit of writing on this topic and many other topics on healthcare. She's going to report a little bit more on North Carolina policy. Katherine?
Thanks, Tom. Thanks, Becky, and everyone at JLF for helping put this event together. Can everyone hear me? So everyone in this room knows that healthcare is extremely complex. It's one of the most heavily regulated industries. And usually healthcare policy decisions always come with federal dictates. Look at Medicaid, it's a jointly funded state-federal program. But so it's really rare when state policymakers have the authority and complete control to improve access to healthcare and improve healthcare freedom for North Carolinians on their own without any government intervention. And certificate of need is one rare opportunity where state legislators can capitalize on this in the short session. If not this short session, hopefully the next long session. So again, just to reiterate what certificate of need is, if providers want to expand an existing service line, or if they want to update major medical equipment like an MRI machine or other imaging services, they have to ask the government permission, and then oftentimes they end up asking their competitors permission for business as well. So this results in lengthy, long drawn out legal battles, which is a lot of time and money away from better patient access to care. So with that said, with my remarks today and the short time we have, I'd just like to talk about three reasons why certificate of need really ought to be repealed. And the first and foremost is that it's an outdated law. It's no longer really relevant. As Chris mentioned when he was talking about the history of certificate of need, our payment structure for hospitals and other providers has changed. It's no longer on a cost-plus system, but rather it's on a predetermined prospective payment system. So there's really less of an incentive for this medical arms race, if you will, to acquire the latest and greatest technology and equipment and services. And so because of that, it's much less of an incentive for hospital systems to do so. And I'll just give you one example. There's many examples as to why this law is outdated, like I was talking about the payment structure. But just if we look at North Carolina's certificate of need law specifically, each CON law in every state varies from the procedural process to who's appointed to the board to determine what is needed, what isn't needed, how these formulas are determined for what is needed. And if we just look at monetary thresholds, for example, so say a physician office wants to update or acquire new diagnostic equipment for breast cancer screening, okay? If the total cost of the equipment is more than $500,000, they have to submit a certificate of need application to become a licensed diagnostic center. So there are some problems here, because with the diagnostic center rule, any monetary threshold of $500,000, that $500,000 amount hasn't been updated for healthcare cost inflation since 1994. So it's easy for many providers, many physician offices, lab imaging centers to blow past this amount, and then they have to be subject to this lengthy onerous process. And it's also easy to surpass this monetary threshold, because that $500,000, that doesn't just apply to maybe major medical equipment that physician office wants to acquire or purchase, but it's the cumulative cost. So if there's any construction or installation fees that goes along with it, that is included in that $500,000 threshold. Which leads to my second point, and what the previous panelists were saying, that this law really, it just stifles innovation in healthcare. It prevents healthcare innovation from flourishing across the state. Technology, as all of you are aware here, it has come such a long way in so many different sectors, and healthcare is one of them. It is just a prime example. Going back to when I was talking about diagnostic centers, I was just talking to a consultant the other day who helped write an application, a CON application for a physician office looking to acquire a 3D mammography scanner. Right now they have a two-dimensional one. And these scanners are more accurate, there's less false positives, it's better for the patient. And another way of looking at this is that the fact that they have to go through this process, the government is limiting patients from accessing life-saving technology. Another example is ambulatory surgery centers. This is another innovative way to deliver healthcare services in a more efficient, smaller, cost-effective setting. 70% of procedures now can be safely performed in an outpatient center. And since 1982, Medicare has deemed these centers to be effective and safe for patients to undergo surgery here. So you know, the fact that Medicare and the federal government deems this safe, but it's silly that the state still has to regulate ambulatory surgery centers, because this just prevents patients from saving money, it prevents providers from operating more efficiently, and it prevents more access in rural healthcare areas where maybe some providers want to band together to start their own ambulatory surgery center that's freestanding. So if you think about the con process, just standing back and looking at it, innovation in healthcare spreads, technology spreads as far as being innovative, but the con process moves so slowly. It's just the con process fails to catch up with healthcare innovation. And the last point I'd just like to say is that this law is riddled with preferential treatment. Last month I was at a public meeting at the Dorothy Dix campus, where the Health and Human Services buildings are, and one of the Certificate of Need planning sections was deliberating over a petition filed by Cape Fear Valley Health System. And Cape Fear Valley Health System, its headquarters are located in Fayetteville, and they are asking for an exemption from the CON process by being able to determine on their own that right now they have a mobile MRI imaging service from Alliance Imaging, and they're looking to acquire their own fixed purchase, their fixed one. But you still need a CON, even for something that you already have, just to be able to swap from having a mobile MRI machine to a fixed one. And the, you know, so Cape Fear Valley Health System, they make a good point by saying, you know, let the market decide, let community hospitals closest to their patients determine whether there's going to be a positive yield on return on investment, whether it's more cost effective for the patient, whether it's better for the hospital system as a whole rather than continuing to lease out their MRI services. But at the same time, it's still preferential treatment because they called for just an exclusive exemption for community hospitals only, not across the board of all types of providers where MRI services can be done. So that point also just further goes to show that centralized planning really is not effective and it doesn't work. And when you have all these special exemptions and tweaks to the law over time, it just goes to show that the market forces should determine what is best and should trust in providers in those areas what is best for their patients. But there is still hope, because in 2005 there was reform. Gastroenterologists could perform colonoscopies and their own endoscopy outpatient units, and as a result, utilization of services did increase by 28%, in large part due to the growing baby boomer population in North Carolina. But despite the increase, even with the increase in utilization of services, Medicare savings still amounted to over $225 million within just 6 years. So just think about that for a minute. That's just one piece of all the 25 services that are regulated and the monetary thresholds that are regulated under the Certificate of Need planning section. So again, I encourage legislators to think about how, you know, given all the parameters within federal regulations and the Affordable Care Act, what you can do at the state level to improve access to health care, which will result in lower costs and more options for patients, especially in rural areas. Thank you.
Thank you, Katherine. I think Senator Hise did a good job of framing this discussion when he asked the question, what's best for the patients? Well, I think a corollary to that is what encourages and supports our physicians who are out in the field trying to do the work. And Dr. John Hicks is going to give us a perspective on how this plays with the healthcare providers. John?
I'd like to thank y'all for having me out here today and for being here to hear me speak. I am an orthopedic surgeon, so I fix bones for a living. So I made a PowerPoint to help myself speak and deliver the message that you guys can hopefully get from a person who's not a speaker, talker, or otherwise verbal individual. All right. So I'm in the Asheville, North Carolina area. I'm with Blue Ridge Bone and Joint. My specialty area is spine surgery, but we are affected by CON all the time. Try to run a medical business is hard enough with the way the landscape is changing. And I'll tell you, as a surgeon and as a doctor, that this business is changing. No doctor who is continuing to work thinks that healthcare is going to stay the same. If people are fighting to make it the same way it was in 1982, they've already retired. We get it. We want to get to where it needs to be to make it work for patients and to work for the government and to work for employers and everybody else who's having to foot the bill. CON does not help that. So, what's the big word? Value. Value is all about the right care for the right patient, the right price, and the right setting for that care. That is driven through market forces, it's driven through contracting, it's driven through patient preferences, it's driven through technology. But this is what we're all talking about. If you look at the hospital from the 50s back here, the largest inpatient private hospital in America, the Baptist in Memphis, it was leveled when I was training. And we get and did our surgery as residents even at outpatient surgery centers where people would come, have an operation and go home an hour later and have a great experience. We don't keep people in the hospital anymore. The demand for resources and the way resources are structured is changing. Pricing. CON laws support high prices. They got the data to prove it. These guys, the economists, have got it. So back when these things were come up with, sure, there was cost plus pricing. Doctors basically got paid usual customary fees. It's not that way anymore. We're all working as hard as we can to have the best price, the best value, or we're gonna get knocked out of all the contracts. We're talking about commercial contracts, not just Medicare and Medicaid. Those are fixed cost systems. The average contract we go after, we're trying to do it better, better quality, lower price, and we need the ammunition to deliver to our citizens for that. So if we have more players, we got lower prices, and we got to do a better job to provide the service our patients want. This guy, he's retired. He was protected by CON laws, and maybe the government needed to be protected from the way that we're naturally driven to function as humans in that market. Utilization, it's kind of been touched on here a little bit. I like the colonoscopy example because colonoscopy is a screening test that people avoid because they don't want to do it. If it's expensive, you're not going to do it, but it saves lives. If you're having more colonoscopies for less money, that's huge value because you're avoiding the treatment of expensive cancers. So physicians, for example, who own physical therapy, refer fewer patients to therapy than those who do not. Their therapy, because it's physician-owned, costs a lot less than commercial or hospital-owned therapy. So the data suggests that when this stuff is physician-owned, not necessarily controlled by the hospital, it can cost less. And insurers have mechanisms to limit this stuff. You go through all this every time you have to have something done and you get a letter from your insurance company that said your doctor prescribed you the wrong medicine or you can't have a study. This stuff is already being tightly regulated, unlike 30 years ago, even 20 years ago, even 10 years ago. Appropriate use criteria are protecting society from unnecessary testing and treatment. So, business side of it. The cost factor. Hospitals are paid 40 to 60% more for the same services as compared to ambulatory non-hospital associated centers. Some surgery centers are considered hospital-owned, so they get to charge full hospital price. What I'm talking about here is an independent surgery center, up to $12,000 more for an ACL. When I looked in my market, Western North Carolina, on Blue Cross Health Choice Select, you can pull out your phone and get the app and see how much it costs you with Blue Cross insurance to have something done. From the most expensive hospital to the ambulatory orthopedic surgery center, the difference in price was $12,000 for a procedure at the base, lowest cost, $9,000. So over 100% of the cost just offsetting society's needs. So I apologize for that, like I said. So the $12,000 per surgery is hard to stomach as protecting society. It makes it a little harder to get doctors to come to North Carolina when they understand that you may not have the entrepreneurial options or the options in where to perform your surgery. Our region in particular has very few ambulatory surgery center options until you're in the hospital to do anything, which is kind of frustrating from the provider. The patient still gets what they need, but it makes it a little tougher to run a business. Operating rooms, when more available, prices fall. Providers are held accountable for the cost of care. Doctors are not able to just perform services and charge whatever they want to anymore. This is an example. I was talking to some guys in Oklahoma that I trained with. They own a hospital. They have a physician-owned freestanding hospital where you can, you know, charge $20,000 for that ACL, but guess what? Nobody can come inside of it because you can't contract like that. So they're building a freestanding ASC so that they can get their price down. This is guys who have the thing that CON is supposed to protect against, realizing that the market has changed and they can't play like that anymore. So it's just another example: open markets, competitive contracting, forcing lower cost and higher quality. All right. So my standpoint, me personally, I think the hospital is limited by this. The same hospitals that we fight against not being able to have our own OR, a month later I'm in a committee meeting talking about OR utilization and which surgeon can't have their block time and who's going to get bumped and who can operate, who can't operate. So at the same time, certain entities are fighting against the expansion of a resource. That limited resource hurts them. A certain hospital can't move the OB unit to the OB floor even though it's better for women, because all the other competitors will fight that certificate to be able to move an operating room you already own. OR can't be built to expand capacity, so hospitals use procedure rooms. It's a little thing that kind of that's written about from the guys at Mercatus and John Locke, how it skews data and allows people to kind of play around the rules. But surgery is done after hours because there's not enough facilities for us to get our work done in the daytime. The story about the hospital in a rural area wanting an MRI unit, I think that's sad, because an MRI unit should be cheap, and it's overpriced historically, but the prices are plummeting on MRI scans because the contracting is there. And if a rural hospital needs to know if a patient's having a stroke so that they can be transferred to a higher level of care or even treated locally, they don't need to ask about if they can buy an MRI, because they should be able to buy one that CMC got rid of because they bought the fanciest one on the market for a great used price and diagnose tumors, strokes, infections locally, so people can be treated either there or get to an appropriate setting without having to go 5 hours to find out they're there for no reason. All right. Sorry about this myself. And if you want to do that, you got to go through a big legal cost. When we talked about, you know, doing joint ventures for ORs, the hospital talks about the value of their CONs, millions of dollars just for the piece of paper, and then the legal process to go through. I'm sorry, I'm just drying up here. So the actual cost and the legal process of the CON makes it very hard to react. As hospitals and systems are trying to provide services. What about cost control? So I can only control the cost when I have control of the process. If my group of orthopedic surgeons, there's 20 doctors in our group, if we have an ambulatory surgery center, we can deliver that care, we can dictate how much we pay for implants, we can control the whole process, and we can really be responsive to our consumers, our patients, and the payers' needs. Already pointed out, 70% of operations are done outpatient basis. Anesthesia and surgery involved. The traditional hospital is no longer the hub of healthcare. People don't come in for a 3-week admission and diagnostic process. People are treated as outpatients. They're treated in the home. Smaller outpatient centers and patient-focused centers are going to be the new face of healthcare. So what do patients want? What do I want for myself and my family? I want the best care. I want the best experience. I want the best price. And I want options. I'm also an employer. We have over 100 employees at Blue Ridge Bone and Joint, and we self-insure. And so I know what this stuff means on a daily basis in terms of the care that I have to fund for myself, my family, and my employees' families. For people who need a transplant surgery, sure, they have to go to a big center. They need to be in a big center. Most folks don't need to be in a big center, and they want options to get stuff done more affordably, closer to home, and cheaper. My wife had a shoulder injury skiing. You know, we're doctors, we do fancy doctor stuff, I'll admit that. But we were skiing and she hurt her shoulder and she had to have surgery. My partner did it and he didn't charge us because he's my partner, but the hospital charged $14,000 for a 1-hour outpatient operation, and I was kind of shocked because I had no idea. You know, we could have gone to the surgery center, and even though my deductible was only $3,500, we self-insure, so my business is on the hook for every penny of that. And so as a business holder, it hit me harder than as a patient. So this stuff is changing big time. CON laws limit our access to care. They protect an oligarchy that controls resources, that sometimes limits resources, that creates arbitrary pricing, and it stifles competition and evolution. So what do we need to do? We need to do away with CON laws. We need to allow the healthcare system to evolve to meet tomorrow's needs, because the way we've thought about things for the last 20 years is irrelevant and it's expired. We got to improve access, lower costs, improve the experience, get the best providers with the best ideas to grow the system. This is my son. He's also been a patient. He's the guy we're trying to design healthcare for when he's going into his 50s, 60s, and 70s, so that it's affordable, so that we're not bankrupt, so that we're getting the care we need at the price we need in the setting we want. So thank you all very much. Now I'll push the button for real.
I think I need to take up orthopedic surgery because despite what you say, you do a very good job of making presentations, John. Thank you very much for that. All right, we're going to take questions from the audience, and I have some questions of my own that I want to ask this panel. So I'm going to ask them to come back up here, and I will caution the panel that the two microphones on the end are sort of the hot microphones, and you may want to consider using them. Donna's got index cards. If anybody would like one, you can write your questions on the card and pass them forward, and we will attempt to take them. A number of questions that I have from, first of all, having studied this, and Connie Wilson has given me an indoctrination in the Certificate of Need over the last couple of years, and along with what Locke Foundation and others are doing. So I'd like to toss to the panel. We repealed Certificate of Need in 1987. 15 states scrapped the CON laws. Why haven't the others? What's the problem? Anybody? Chris?
Well, yeah, I think a number of states, the reason why they passed Certificate of Need laws in the first place was to comply with the federal mandate. So North Carolina passed their laws in 1978, along with a whole slew of others that did it for no other reason than Congress made them. With that being said, there were eight or so states that had actually written sunshine provisions in their original Certificate of Need statutes, which said at any moment, if the federal government repeals the mandate, our statute will go away unless the legislature takes an affirmative step. So that explains some of the early repeal. Some of the other states over time, Wisconsin, Indiana, I think it's just legislators that had realized that the law had served its time, if it ever had a time, and it was time to move on. For the remaining states, I think while it seems, and we've presented it as a very easy option when it comes to the facts, the numbers, and everything else, there's no denying that it's a politically difficult decision to make. Like there are clearly entrenched interests that have a large financial stake in seeing the continuation of this program, as the doctor was mentioning before. There are individuals in all of these 36 states in D.C. that still have them that stand to lose financially, but that shouldn't be what healthcare regulation is about. It shouldn't be about the business side. It should be about what's best for patients.
All right, I endeavor every week to present balanced debate for the old North State. So, okay, you're a hospital. And John, you talked about the expense. Katherine, you talked about the expense in buying these CAT scan machines, the MRI units, $1 million investments by the time you get through with the legal process and so forth like that. Okay, I'm a hospital. I spent this $1 million, and now you're going to get rid of CON, and I'm going to have competition down the street. How's that going to work out, Katherine?
Well, this law, it really is protectionist policy. The status quo likes to have Certificate of Need in place because it protects them from competition. They can acquire. The thing in North Carolina is that if you're a licensed facility, you need a Certificate of Need. So once you have that Certificate of Need, it makes it more difficult for outside entrants to compete with you in the market. So when you're talking about ambulatory surgery centers, it's very difficult for new entrants to come in.
I got that.
Right.
We're going to repeal CON.
Yes.
Ralph Hise said we're going to get rid of CON.
Mm-hmm.
I've spent this $1 million
mm-hmm.
or better. Now, what am I supposed to do now as a hospital?
Well, that's what competition's about.
Okay, but some guy down the street's going to go open up, and am I just going to write this $1 million investment off? Is that the way that's going to work?
Well, no. I mean, you may have. Sure. The hospitals, in large part, do not want Certificate of Need to go away because, say, you have an ambulatory surgery center open up, they're nervous that they're going to lose out on their most lucrative service lines because under the federal government requirement under EMTALA, they're required to accept everybody that comes through their doors. So that is one of the hot topic debates that we consistently hear about as a sticking point. because if you lose those lucrative service lines, is this going to close down a hospital because you have an ambulatory surgery center opening up and they're taking away those lucrative service lines from you at a much lower cost?
John, one of the things that Senator Hise talked about was he didn't know how this was going to work. There's been some suggestions that perhaps maybe the way to do this with the least harm to the fewest people is to phase out this over a period of time. As a doc, what would you think of that?
I think it makes sense. There's certainly low-hanging fruit that would be easy to get rid of, things like MRI that Dan Murray and Charlotte described as an overpriced commodity, not an overutilized commodity. I think that community hospitals in rural areas could benefit from imaging and things like that. But you know, the big hospital systems, the for-profits, are very lucrative. They're not going to get hurt by losing $1 million if they had an administrator who's on the clock fill out the paperwork for. And the community hospitals that are not-for-profit have tax protections that help to protect them. So I think as this stuff is phased out, there's worry, but it's going to be growing pains that are part of the process that's described as going from one airplane to another, except we're at 30,000 feet. That's the healthcare market right now. Yeah.
Chris, you want to comment on that?
Yeah, and I think to add to that, the data show that, you know, that healthcare markets in states that have repealed certificate of need laws aren't imploding. If the fear is that repealing certificate of need means all of these ambulatory surgery centers are going to come in, cream skim, poach all the good self-pay, well-insured patients and leave the hospitals with nothing, and they'll somehow implode on themselves because they can no longer sustain financially. The data, they just don't show that. You know, 30% more overall hospitals in non-con versus certificate of need states, more ambulatory surgery centers in non-certificate of need states versus certificate of need states. So overall, the data indicate that, you know, hospitals aren't exactly just disappearing. In fact, there are more hospitals in con state, or in non-con states versus con.
Catherine,
states.
I always learn something when I read you or I listen to you, and you told me something today that was absolutely fascinating to me, and that was, since 1994, if you wanted to purchase a new machinery, new technology or whatever like that, below $500,000, you didn't have to apply for CON.
Right.
Above $500,000, you did. That hasn't changed, even though the cost of these toys has gone up pretty dramatically. We've got a 24-member board that goes through and approves all of this over a lengthy period of time. Is it up to this board to change that threshold? Is that a legislative threshold? Who can change that?
Well, you know, that's a great question. I'm not 100% positive, but I believe that would have to be a legislative decision. I know in the past that there are other exemptions. In 2013, there's been exemptions for existing healthcare facilities for certain monetary thresholds. For example, if you want to update major medical equipment beyond $2 million, you do not need to go through the certificate of need process for that. But that's for existing facilities. That's not for facilities or providers who want to enter the market.
All right. We have 635,000 annual surgical procedures in North Carolina. John, you said 70% of them are now being performed as outpatient, on an outpatient basis, which means to me that they could be done in an ambulatory surgical center just as easily as they could in the hospital, and yet the hospital is charging up to 58% more for the same procedures as an ASC would. How do they get away with that?
That's a great question. I'm sure there's a lot of layers.
By the way, anytime anybody answers and responds, that's a great question, it means I don't know what I'm going to say about it.
I mean, there's no black and white answer. It's not based on, you know, think tank economics. There's no agnostic mathematic equation that describes it unemotionally. A lot of the highest prices are, you know, price protections where there still exists cost plus in safety net hospitals where sometimes you even hear about procedures being shifted because they can be afforded or higher revenue items. So the highest cost may be some of those rural protections. But hospitals have great lobbying. They have a lot of sympathy from society because they do care for the poor and they offer emergency department services, which physicians participate in as delivering that care. But for a lot of reasons, they're allowed to charge more for
for the same service?
All right, let's drill down on that caring for the poor, indigent care. First of all, I think they estimate it's like $1.8 billion worth of indigent care in North Carolina per year. Is that correct? But there are compensations for that too, aren't there, Chris? I mean, they don't have to pay sales tax. They don't have to pay income tax. They don't have to pay property taxes. They're not for profit. Doesn't that sort of balance off?
Certainly, but with the charity care point, I think it's something to point out here is that when you look at it, the national numbers for charity care, you compare certificate of need states versus non-certificate of need states, there's no relationship between the presence of a CON program and any increase in charity care. So the idea that somehow having a certificate of need program is protecting this hospital that is then providing charity care, that's not borne out in the numbers. There seems to be no statistical relationship. So in states where hospitals have to compete with ambulatory surgery centers on everything, there's no statistical difference in the amount of charity care being provided.
John, you made a statement that I'd like for you to drill down a little bit more and talk about. You said that when you are in charge of the process as a physician or provider, you can control the cost a lot better. The inference I got from that was that when you're working inside a hospital, you go by their protocols, their procedures, their policies, their staffing. Tell us more about that.
Well, the hot word in proceduralist medicine is bundles. Right now, North Carolina has CCJR bundles, which Medicare participants who receive a total joint replacement, the hospital system or the episode initiator, at our group, it's us, we're an episode initiator, we're paid a fixed amount of money for that procedure for the 90-day global that goes towards it. And we're held to the line by the federal government, which is different. But private insurers, GE, commercial insurance companies want us to be able to deliver the quality and the price, and we have to go to bat and negotiate for that. But it's harder for me to control all the aspects of that price and delivery when I have to go through for basic things, outpatient surgery, a carpal tunnel, you know, to use the hospital's pricing, the hospital's markups, the hospital staff, makes it a little harder, which is why you hear about nationwide contracting. North Carolina could really lose out if price protections elevate our price and all of a sudden all of our GE employees, instead of leaving Henderson County and going to Charlotte to have their joints done as part of GE's bundle program, they could start going to Cleveland Clinic to have them. And a lot of employers are doing this across the country. When local care gets too expensive, they're savvy enough to put their employees on an airplane and pay for their spouse's hotel room, pay for their travel, because it costs that much less. We're talking about procedures that are $75,000 overall versus $18,000 for the same procedure. And we're at risk economically as a statewide medical system to keep our good business at home.
Katherine, you want to add to that? You look like you're getting ready to say something.
No.
Okay, so the hospitals claim if we repeal CON, they're going to go out of business, or it's going to drastically affect their profitability. I assume that means they're going to be shifting more cost to the patients who are paying for these things. But how do we know that that is true? I mean, has that been the experience elsewhere? Chris, you've been studying this nationwide.
It doesn't seem to be the case. I mean, you have states as diverse as Texas and California that have repealed their certificate of need programs here.
Have they seen patients flee from them after the hospitals, after they repealed them?
Patients fleeing from them?
Yeah,
I don't think so.
And
also, I think just anecdotally, it doesn't seem to be the case. But also, you look at those, neither of those places seem to be described as, you know, healthcare deserts. They seem to be doing okay. The hospitals are doing okay there. And when you think that, you know, a third of the states almost, in some states as few as one or two covered items, that there's a huge, not every certificate of need program is the same. Again, North Carolina's fourth most restrictive. You go down the list and you see the ones that are less restrictive, their healthcare markets are doing a-okay. And I mean, that has to do more
with
their
national
trend.
Have you done any study to indicate that hospitals in CON states are any more or less healthy than hospitals in non-CON states?
I haven't done any study on this, although that doesn't mean that others haven't looked at the issue.
All right. So one of the factors involved initially in 1974 was to prevent the overbuying of these new gizmos so that it didn't put a financial burden on hospitals and other care providers. There is almost some moral issue here with let's don't spend more, buy more, have more, just to have the latest gee whiz toys. How do we make sure that that is not going to get overused, that the ASCs are not going to get overused? Is this completely supply and demand? Should there be some regulation, Katherine?
Well, no, I think that, like any other business, I mean, a lot of businesses fail, but if you're a savvy business person, you can detect your external market analysis of what services are needed in your area. I think if you just let the market forces work and get rid of government regulation over life-saving technology and access to better health care, especially at a lower cost, that's the way to go. A certificate of need is an outdated system.
I'd like to go ahead, Chris.
It's also historically what you see, and there, you know, very early studies showed this consistently. Certificate of need programs cover most things, but not everything. And so what you actually saw was providers shifting investments. Hospitals didn't spend less on things. They just started investing in non-covered items, right? You say certificate of need is needed for X machine, they just started buying some other machine. Now that we have it was a less competitive market, I think we're in a much more competitive environment, which places the onus on these individuals to make better decisions. And you see that. I mean, I don't think you're seeing people making bad business decisions when they're thinking about buying machines. I'm sure.
Well, the whole healthcare industry is not very competitive. I think we can all pretty much agree with that. I mean, it is a fairly restricted thing. John, talk about patient safety here. Well, you disagree with that.
It's competitive on the provider side.
It is
easier to get a medical degree, I think, than it is to get an operating room in North Carolina.
Memo to self. Talk about patient safety. We're going to open up all these ASCs. We're going to do these new surgical procedures. How can I, as a consumer, a patient, be assured that when I go into your center, that I'm going to be safe and that it's going to be done correctly and so forth like that?
Nobody wants to practice bad medicine, that's for sure. Outpatient surgery centers, ambulatory surgery centers have a great track record of safety. And they're inspected just like hospitals are. You have the same providers using the same equipment with the same anesthesia machines, just in a different setting that's more convenient to the patient, that costs a heck of a lot less money to society. So safety has been addressed. It's been studied intensively. And I don't think we like to use the word pushing the envelope, but there are people who are, you know, seeing how much can be done in an outpatient setting safely, and people do pilot studies, and people work in a hospital setting with the same day discharge before those things are brought fully into an ambulatory center. But that's on everybody's mind.
Well, I'd also like to mention, I mean, Medicare has been reimbursing these ambulatory surgery centers since 1982. So the fact that that's been proven safe and effective since 1982, yet ASCs are still regulated under certificate of need. And Dr. Hicks, you were talking about, patient safety and everything, but also, and pilot projects, demonstration projects to determine if is this good thing to do statewide or repeal this regulation statewide. Well, in 2010, North Carolina had a demonstration pilot project for allowing a special needs exemption for single specialty ambulatory surgery centers, and they allowed for three of them in metropolitan areas. But, you know, it just seems silly to think that here we are in the year 2010, where the Certificate of Need Regulatory Planning section thinks that this is some innovative pilot project idea when this has been proven to be safe and effective for patients since the 1980s.
What were the results of that pilot project in 2010, by the way?
Well, there's definitely savings, and as far as, ambulatory surgery centers on average save Medicare $2.5 billion every year, but there is also a charity care requirement. All of them exceeded their charity care requirements. I know one, I think, believe Triangle Orthopedic Associates provided over 9% of charity care for all of their services.
We had a bill in the legislature this past year, HB 100, which had a lot of provisions in it, and it got up to about the 10-yard line and never crossed the goal so far as being passed was concerned. One of the provisions was that there was a 7% mandate for charity care. There were several other provisions that don't come to my mind right now. If we were going to repeal CON, would you like to see some stipulations in a reform bill, and what would they be? I'd ask all three of you.
Okay. I don't, reform stipulations or conditions on upon a repeal bill?
Or? Yeah, if we were going to reform CON, are there any stipulations like this? Mm-hmm. For instance, in communities of, what was it, less than 100,000?
Right. Well, the problem with that bill is that, I mean, that bill has good intentions of the idea of preserving rural healthcare access, but the problem with that bill is that it actually harms rural healthcare because the House Bill 200 said that if you want to build an ambulatory surgery center, you could only do so, you would be exempt from the CON process in counties above 100,000 people population. Well, that's really only pertains to 25 counties. There's 100 counties in North Carolina, so that means that 75 counties would not have 70 patients living in 75 counties won't have access to closer healthcare services through an ambulatory surgery center.
Chris, I was very fascinated by the fact that you said that people in rural communities are going to larger communities for these services anyway. Why is that? They've got a hospital in their own rural community. Why don't they go there?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, Katherine has done a lot of great work on this showing, you know, patient migration within North Carolina. Our study looked at nationally people leaving the state. So, for example, you have people who perhaps are in, you know, Western Carolina, and they're going to Georgia, Tennessee, perhaps South Carolina. I think the reason is they have more options. Perhaps it's cheaper. Maybe they're self-pay, or a whole host of reasons. But what you find is across the board, between PET scans, MRI scans, and CT scans, you're talking something like, just due to the presence of CON, there's, you know, something like 40,000 scans from people in a state like North Carolina going out of state. Those are all scans that would otherwise be done within state. That's business for local ambulatory surgery centers. That's continued patients for local hospitals that, because of this program, they're leaving the state to do it. I can't say why each and every one of them are, but, you know, controlling for everything we can, you can drill down and say...
Well, even within the state, Katherine, you said that they are going to...
There are many areas in more rural areas in North Carolina, but there's still opportunity to have a viable ambulatory surgery center become established. But in fact, there's very large migration rates. The percentage of people who are getting outpatient surgery are migrating, large percentages of them, to major metropolitan areas simply because there's limited access in where they live.
All right, let's assume again that we're going to reform CON, we're going to stage this in over a period of time. What are the procedures? What are the surgeries or scans or whatever you would recommend that we start with eliminating immediately? John, I'll start with you on that. Let me guess. Orthopedic surgery.
All of it.
I don't
see how a lot of this stuff really fits with the market anymore. Prices are controlled through contracting. If you want to maintain high prices, you're going to lose the business. Maybe there's things like particle accelerators that I guess are becoming more common. But when I was 15 years ago, you heard that, you know, Hopkins and some other big institution in the Northeast are having an arms race as to who can have the biggest particle accelerator for their cancer program. But beyond things that are extravagant and don't really need a major regional population to support, I don't think that CON is that valid in terms of imaging, MRI.
So you're an all or nothing at all guy.
Exactly. I don't really think that it's necessary. I don't think.
Chris, let me hear from you and Katherine too on that.
Yeah. I think he's spot on. You know, when the FTC commented last year on the reform efforts, Commissioner Josh Wright wrote a separate concurrence with the FTC, and I have to say I agree with him. He says, you know, reform is nice, reform is good, but repeal is really what you know, reform-minded people should be focused on. And again, I would note that most of the studies that we've done, they don't differentiate between a more or less restrictive program. They say simply having a program in and of itself is correlated with all the things I've been mentioning. So I would say maybe not, you know. Now again, I get to sit here as a researcher. I don't have to make the political calculations that folks, you know, there might have to. But I would say, you know, if the end of the day you're really focused on patients, reform is nice, but repeal is ultimately what you
should. Katherine, we've been talking about reform. What these guys are talking about is outright repeal. You agree with that?
Yes, I completely agree with repeal. And if you reform, there's so many unintended consequences. They may have good intentions. Reform may have good intentions, but there's unintended consequences that result from that. For example, operating rooms are currently regulated under North Carolina Certificate of Need Law, but back in 2012, procedure rooms are now equivalent to operating rooms, and procedure rooms aren't regulated under CON law. And as you were mentioning earlier, Chris, if you have one thing similar that's regulated compared to one thing that isn't, of course providers are going to go for the easy path. And so now it looks like there's this underreported need, so to say, for operating rooms. Because if you have a certificate of need for an operating room, you can just build as many procedure rooms as you want.
This was obviously written by someone who is knowledgeable in the insurance industry, so I'm going to read it because I can't paraphrase it. Dr. Hicks, you mentioned that insurance companies used utilization management tools to control utilization and cost. Step therapy is a tool used by insurers to manage utilization and pharmacy costs. Doctors today are encouraging passage of HB 1048, which would gut step therapy, increasing premiums an estimated 4 to 5%. How do we avoid these same battles for MRIs and other utilization when CON is repealed? Did you understand the question? Because I didn't.
I do.
Okay.
I get what they're asking. You know, when there's more MRI machines, MRIs get cheaper. You know, an MRI is not a $2,000 study. An MRI is a $400 to $600 study that just happens to be overpriced in many settings. And so just like the colonoscopy example, when the price falls, even though there's increased utilization, overall the value is going through the roof because you're getting more for less money overall. The pharmaceutical thing's changing too. I mean, I don't want to prescribe my patients drugs that they're going to get feedback from their pharmacy company that's inappropriate, and I don't want to be, you know, perceived as a doctor who's going after everything that's glitzy. I want to be smart, and I want to make good recommendations that are evidence-based that support value for my patients. I have a high deductible plan, so I don't have to. I tell my doctor, hey, we're on step zero. Whatever's cheapest and generic and old. So I think that the more people are empowered to make decisions and to see the consequences of those decisions, I mean, when it comes down to the healthcare consumer consuming healthcare instead of being a player in a third-party transaction, the more we're consumers in it, the less you have to worry about the end result of that cost. So I do support higher deductible plans just to help people with those day-to-day decisions with regards to the cost of their drugs month to month. But it can be frustrating when people aren't doing well with a drug that's first line and they feel like they have to jump through a lot of red tape and they feel like they're paying a lot of money for their care.
A lot of docs today, particularly family physicians, are waking up to the reality that as much as anything else, they're working for the insurance companies rather than working for the patients because they spend so much back office time pushing paper and filing claims and so forth like that, not just for the insurance companies, but also for Medicare and Medicaid. I'd be interested in hearing, do y'all have any knowledge as to how insurance companies feel about CON reform or repeal?
Well, I do know that United Health Group put forth a policy, I believe last October, and if a patient is going to get surgery, if it can be performed in a freestanding outpatient setting, they need prior approval if that patient is not going to be having surgery in that setting, as far as the cost containment measure.
Any other feedback on how insurance companies like CON reform or repeal?
If you can save 60% every time, they like that.
Well, we'd like to think that it would lower insurance premiums, wouldn't we?
Or make the current insurance market sustainable. I think that, you know, Blue Cross is with the Obamacare pool experiences under some stress, and the insurers, you know, they're consolidating too. There's a lot of signs of stress in their business, and so, like I said, business as usual is thrown out the window. If you think that it's going to be the way it was, we got to have more opportunity to make new design.
Yeah, we saw United Healthcare pull out of North Carolina for Affordable Care Act. Blue says they lost $400 million in the first 2 years of ACA, and they're kind of wobbling on the idea of this. Does that relate to what we're talking about so far as CON?
Well, yeah, absolutely, because, I mean, under Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, whatever you'd like to call it, you know, it focuses on reducing the number of uninsured. So if you're going to have more people, an increase in demand for healthcare services, you might as well repeal laws that stifle innovation and stifle the supply of healthcare to make it more affordable.
Any questions out there we didn't answer that you would like to have answered? We have 4 whole minutes left. Be glad to tackle any of them. I'm going to give you 60 seconds to give us your takeaway and final positions on all this. Katherine, I'll start with you.
Sure. Certificate of Need, its original intent was to ensure quality access and improve health care, especially in rural areas, but the takeaway is that it does just the opposite.
You didn't take your whole 60 seconds. Chris, 60 seconds.
Yeah, I think this is in sum, everything I think you've been hearing from all of us today, this old outmoded laws that have long lived any justification that they ever had. The delivery of healthcare is changing, and the data support that if you're interested in increasing access, increasing care, lowering price, increasing competition, and getting things to people in the way that they want them, restricting who can enter, expand, and invest in the delivery of healthcare in a particular state seems to be counterintuitive to all of that. And Certificate of Need is certainly doing that.
John, 60 seconds.
We enjoy great hospital care, hospice care, operating imaging in North Carolina. The entities that are protected by CON are fantastic, and I think they're safe in an open market. As physicians, we compete with each other all the time, and we don't have any of these protections. But I think that the CON laws hurt them as much as they hurt anybody else who wants to be in that market. So getting North Carolina, getting America to where it needs to be in terms of delivering health care that we can afford in an appropriate way, it's got to mean less regulation, and CON is not a part of the future.
And it is entirely appropriate that we are in the General Assembly auditorium, because the decisions on CON are going to be made right outside in the two chambers. So I guess that means if you're in favor of reform or repeal, you have work to do. I want to thank our panelists. First of all, Senator Ralph Hise, who had to leave us to go cast some votes on the floor. Hopefully they were for repeal of CON. I'd like to thank Chris Koopman, who came to us from George Washington University and the Mercatus Center. Katherine Restrepo, who does quite a bit of analysis for Health and Human Services for the John Locke Foundation. And Dr. John Hicks, a very refreshing and very encouraging report from you. I was glad to hear your remarks, and we thank you so much. And we want to thank all of you who came here today to hear this. I hope that you have learned something. I hope you have been challenged by this, and I hope it will be something that you can take away with you as you consider this discussion, a very important part of, as I said earlier, the issue of our era, healthcare. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.